Hallo Malti Maquiladoris, and thank you to Lee Padilla for that malt mention. This is Ralfy Review 684, and I'm Ralfy. This is the Manx Bothy, and this is a bottle of single malt whiskey called Ballechin. It's a non-Islay, heavily peated single malt that you've quite possibly never heard of. Allow me to introduce you to it by giving it a Ralfy review. Excuse me a second, just adjust my peripheral lighting there. You missed the cork popping. It wasn't a very spectacular cork pop. Let's try again. That's more like it. There we go. Just a wee drop, not too much. No point in being greedy. This is 10-year-old peated Edradour from the central highlands of Scotland in a very picturesque tourist trap place called Pitlochry, famous for its fusty Victorian hotels, guest houses, quaint high street and salmon ladder. And the salmon ladder is basically a stepped concrete waterfall thing that allows migrating salmon to get to bypass a dam. There we go. So now you know all about Pitlochry. I worked there once. I hated it. It wasn't for very long. Right. Ooh. This is bottled at 46% volume. It's unchill filtered and it's natural colour. All good. Even when you look at the bottle on its own, you can see a certain healthy haze inside there, which gives a good suggestion as to the authenticity and the craft production of this whisky being made at Edradour, a small craft hands-on distillery with the unique feature of a cooling system which is also used in pasteurising milk. Although at Edradour Distillery they don't actually pasteurise any milk, but they use a similar canal cooling system, right, which they're proud to show visitors because it's kind of fairly unique. Also at Edradour they've got a pretty spectacular bottle shop as part of the distillery, and where you can buy all the range of the Edradours and Ballechins, but also a quite extensive range of the independent bottling called Signatory. And importantly, you tend to get some quite good prices, particularly when the trend is in Scotland that the most expensive place to buy a whisky tends to be the distillery itself. Not always, but frequently the case. Right. You will notice, maltmates, I've not added any water yet. I won't be adding any water. Unusual, I know. For you Ralfy regulars, you'll be saying, what, Ralfy? No teaspoon? No teaspoon, no water, no careful measuring out of allotted water to enhance the nose and smell and taste and all the rest of it? No. Because when I've been doing my methodical research, and it is fairly methodical, I've discovered fairly early on that water doesn't help this whiskey. It simply makes it taste more dilute. If you're going to add any water at all, I would suggest no more than a few drops. I'm going to review this neat. It works best for me neat. On the nose, slightly sour barley sugar and smoky, ashy peatiness, a Kalila ashiness and a slight Lagavulin smokiness, if you know what I mean, if you know your Islay whiskies. And it's quite significantly peated, definitively peated. If you're a fan of Islay peated single malts like Lefroy, Gardbeg and Lagavulin, you are going to enjoy the alternative novelty of this in the same way that you would gravitate to, say, peated Springbank called Longrow, or the occasional younger versions of Lechaig or Ardmore. It's fairly youthful, as you would expect for 10-year-old whiskey, but of course that youthfulness helps to maintain the integrity of the high phenolic content. And it so happens they state in the back of the label that the phenolic content of the malted barley is 50 parts per million. And I'm going to come back to that shortly at the end of this malt mark part of the review and address the parts per million thing in a bit more detail. What else have we got in the nose? I've given it a few minutes in the glass. I'm holding it in my hand to warm it up slightly, like you would with a brandy goblet. In cold countries with cold climates, like where I am, you would warm the whiskey in your hand a little bit. But in hot countries, you may be better with a stemmed glass to try and keep the whiskey cooler for longer. Just a suggestion, maltmates. There is some sour citrus, some rind in there. It's a sort of combination of grapefruit and lime rind. There's a touch of mineral oil, almost linseed, definitely slight puttyish note. One of the things that's kind of put me off this a bit in pre-tastings, in rehearsals, has been the sour yeasty note which comes across. This is very much what I call the old-fashioned style of single malt. It isn't clean and fresh and slightly clinical for the modern palate. There are notes in here which are a little bit initially off, and this is the reason why you have to give the whiskey a bit more time in the glass, because it's not basically like a microwave meal. It's just ready to go once it's been heated. It doesn't work that way. This is one of these old-fashioned recipes. You've got to cut up the ingredients and give it a bit more time. Rotten analogy, but I'm going to press on now. There is, without doubt, some finer, pleasant vanilla notes and a slight wood complex note, American oak, that vanilla, slight tanniny note in the background. It's a demanding whiskey. It's one that you're not going to rush. If you are knocking it back within about 10, 15, even 20 minutes, you're really getting a shortened event and you may not be impressed with it. This one needs patience, but it will reward you so long as you give it enough time, primarily. This is part of a series that's been on the go since 2014. So we're into the third year where there's been a selection of 46% bottled Ballechins, which have been matured primarily in wine casks, and they've actually worked really well. But latterly, they've been using ex-bourbon casks, and I don't think that it benefits from the lack of that wine fruity note, which has helped to add a certain layer of character to the Ballechin style, which is now sort of missing a little bit with this bourbon matured version. Taste. The initial arrival, sweet and sour barley sugar, and a big steady peat blast arrival, which would do any Isla whiskey proud. It's quite convincing. It's not apologetic. It's assertive. And it tends to actually, the youthfulness, numb the palate slightly, particularly in the midsection of the tongue and in the roof of the mouth. And what that does, unfortunately, is it really sort of deadens some of the complexities of this whiskey. But in this instance, because it's a bit rough, not rough, just a bit rough, it actually helps if your palate's slightly anaesthetised and the focus of your experience is really on the peatiness rather than the grain activity, rather than the intrinsic edredure spirit content of this. The development isn't particularly complex or long, and the finish is a little bit light. Light vanilla, some jasmine tea, some sour ginger, well, quite a big dollop of sour ginger, and some rather aggressive tannins. It really is as if you've got the foundations of a really good single malt here, but the calibre of the bourbon cask has not quite delivered the desired result. This is still a competent, engaging and worthy alternative to an Islay single malt. I have tasted some Islay single malts of the same age which are not as good as this. Having said that, I would have given it 2 more years in the cask just to get that finer balance of more cask involvement, a little more sweetness from the cask to dull down that slightly hot, sour nature in the edredure spirit. And hopefully it wouldn't have compromised that delightful, raw, fresh, and slightly, well, pleasantly aggressive, phenolic, peated overcoat that this single malt is wearing. Malt marks, I'm going to give this 83 out of 100. And that, malt mates, is a malt mark. Right, parts per million. Let me remind you what that's all about, because it's something that distillers don't mention in their marketing or in their packaging unless it happens to be a peated whiskey. So you never get your PPM for esters or aldehydes. It's always phenols. Now, what's actually going on here is quite simple. This was a kind of trend started, funnily enough, by Bruichladdy. When they brought out their Octomore, and they were saying, basically, if Lagavulin and Lefroig are roughly 55 or 60 parts per million in the computer analysis of the chemical composition of malted barley from Port Ellen maltings, because of course everything's computer controlled and printouts and readings and analytics, which distillers are quite keen to see, even if it doesn't really translate into the product. And it became a marketing feature of the strength of the phenolic composition of a whiskey is the parts per million. However, it's all very well to say, well, you know, there are phenol, naturally derived phenol chemicals numbering 100 parts per million, 120, 160, which is now where Octomore's really up to. But that doesn't necessarily give you any indication of what the final taste is going to be. So when you see parts per million in advertising and marketing, if it went through the extremely tall, narrow stills of Glenmorangie compared to the short, very fat stills of Lagavulin, you can use exactly the same parts per million ferment and wash to create your peated spirit. But the shape of the stills are going to be totally different in their action. So in Lagavulin, the content parts per million of phenols is going to translate into the produced spirit far more intact and dramatically than through the Glenmorangie stills, which are so particularly tall, with more reflux, with more refinement of the spirit, with more knocking back during distillation of the heavier, physically heavier compounds, which are phenols, because phenols are heavy compounds, because there's a lot of molecules in the molecular chain of a phenol. An ester or aldehyde is a lot lighter because there's far fewer molecules in the molecular chain of esters and aldehydes. And so when you see these parts per million, it gives you some sort of benchmark indication, but it's not telling you really as much as the distillers and producers are suggesting that you should take from that messaging. So be aware of that. Now, it so happens that at Edradour, they've got small, squat stills. So the rather like Tobermory, where you can get incredibly heavily peated lechigs, 6 years old, 7 years old, absolute mega peat bombs. Even, you know, more peaty than Lagavulin, more peaty than Lefroig. In fact, it's well known in legend now that when batches of young lechig were being put through the pipes at the bottling plant from the vat, storage vat, into the bottles to be sealed as lechig, they'd actually have to rinse out the pipes with clean water several times to get rid of the phenolic residues coating the inside of the pipes. Otherwise they would have contaminated, albeit in a very pleasant way, but they would have affected the flavour of the whisky that was in the run after this lechig. And you've got this full blast phenolic character here in Ballechin, simply because Edradour's stills are small, they're squat stills, they're really squat pots, and you have members of staff standing over these stills producing the whisky in the old-fashioned way, which is why this phenolic integrity is so intact, and it's really carrying this whisky into the review zone. It's over 80 out of 100. And the reason I'm marking it and recommending it, it boils down to this phenolic character. It's very much in evidence. It's quite entertaining. It's quite satisfying. But if you add any water, by the way, it's just going to taste dilute. It's not going to help it or help it express itself anymore. There's a certain slight misting, scotch misting appearing in the glass now. There would be more if I'd added water to this. Simple as that. But I'm not. One more smell and taste before I go. Okay then. Just letting it sit in the glass, there is a certain fruity note, honey, slightly Moscovado, rich sultana, dry sultana note. And I don't normally do this, maltmates, but in this instance, I'm going up the mark a bit. I feel I've been a little bit unfair there. 84 out of 100. There we go. That's better. I feel a bit less guilty now about being over-judgmental about a whisky which, to me, is just a little bit... it's just a little bit raw. But having said that, there's many, many whisky fans love a raw, slap-in-the-face-with-a-wet-fish style peated single malt. That is the actual appeal. And it's down to personal tastes. And I would conclude by saying that we tend to discuss personal tastes in terms of the form of a whisky or the flavour components of a whisky. But it's also the case that, particularly with phenolics, earthy, raw, untamed phenolic harshness can be of great appeal to many modern single malt Scotch whisky drinkers, because it's such a definitive and clear, distinctive, unapologetic experience. And it's something which I think, you know, I'm looking for a bit more balance myself, but that's my personal tastes. And I'm quite convinced that anyone who really loves their slapdash, fishy kipper, smoky fireside, heavily peat smoky whiskies would quite possibly give this 87 or 88 of 100. It's a personal thing, and we should never lose sight of that. I'm Ralphy. I'm done here. I'm moving along now. I've got a cup of tea to get and some stuff to read up on to do my research for my next Ralphy review, which is going to be another rather heavy, smoky, peaty whiskey that's kind of distiller's edition-ish, latest version. Right, I've given it away. I know I have. I'm Ralphy. Bye-bye for now.